Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. My name is Phil Hannaford. I'm Vice Principal for Research and Knowledge Exchange in the University. And it's a great pleasure to invite you to the seventh of R.V. Jones Engineering Lecture. I'm a GP by background, so engineering has got nothing to do with my background, but I know it's got a lot to do with my life. And when I'm really bored, or want to bore the children, I love watching mega engineering on Channel 5 or whatever. And so that's probably the tabloid version of engineering. I've been to several of these lectures, and they've helped to open my mind and demonstrate some of the different aspects of engineering. I'm sure we'll hear a lot more tonight. My job tonight is to welcome you, to do the housekeeping bits, that if there is a fire alarm, it's not a test, certainly not this time of the day. So if there is an alarm, we just move quietly out the emergency doors and we'll be here to guide anyone who needs extra help. That we'll have Steve Logan, who is our Senior Vice Principal, introduce our speaker. We'll have the speaker, then we'll have an element of questions and answers after the lecture, and then I hope you'll be able to join us for some refreshments after the lecture. And I know that it's bound to be an interesting time, because I've, as I said, the previous lectures that I've been to have been very interesting. So without any more ado, I would like to introduce Steve Logan, who is our Senior Vice Principal for the University, who will introduce our speaker.
Thank you, Phil. Ladies and gentlemen, can I echo Phil Hannaford's welcome to you this evening, where it's my pleasure as the Senior Vice Principal to introduce tonight's speaker, Professor Lynn Gladden, CBE, FRS and FRNG. Professor Gladden is currently the Pro Vice Chancellor for Research at the University of Cambridge and Shell Professor of Chemical Engineering in the Department of Chemical Engineering and Biotechnology. She's also the director of the Magnetic Resonance Research Centre in the Department of Chemical Engineering and Biotechnology at Cambridge. Prior to moving to the field of chemical engineering in 1987, she graduated in chemical physics at the University of Bristol and studied for a PhD in the Department of Physical Chemistry at Cambridge. Her major research interests lie in the development and application of magnetic resonance and terahertz techniques in chemical engineering, with particular interest in applied catalysis. Professor Gladden is a very distinguished scientist and engineer. She's a fellow of the Royal Society, the Royal Academy of Engineering, the Royal Society of Chemistry, and the Institute of Physics. In 1996, she was awarded a Miller Visiting Professorship at the University of California, Berkeley, and in 2000, the Tilden Lectureship and Silver Medal of the Royal Society of Chemistry. In 2013, she was awarded the Bakerian Lecture of the Royal Society. Her influence is wide-ranging. She also holds honorary appointments at Beijing University of Chemical Technology and NTU Singapore. In addition to her activities within the University of Cambridge, Professor Gladden is a member of the International Advisory Panel of the Journal of Chemical Engineering Science, the Royal Society and Royal Academy of Engineering Advisory Group to the National Physical Laboratory, and the International Advisory Board of the McDermott Institute for Advanced Materials and Nanotechnology in New Zealand. Lynn Gladden was awarded an OBE for services to chemistry in 2001 and a CBE for services to chemical engineering in 2009. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm delighted to welcome such an eminent scholar to Aberdeen this evening and look forward to her R.V. Jones lecture entitled Taking Magnetic Resonance Imaging from Medicine into Chemical Engineering. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Gladden.
Well, thank you very much for that very kind introduction, and thank you to the University of Aberdeen for inviting me here to give this R.V. Jones Distinguished Lecture. I'm greatly honoured by having been invited up here, and obviously to meet up with old friends like Jim Anderson there. So first of all, I'm going to start off by thanking my research group, because even in a lecture like this, it's important to recognise the guys that actually do the work. So that's a snapshot of them outside our main lab, magnetic resonance lab in Cambridge. And in particular, my two senior colleagues, who basically keep the ship afloat while I'm off doing all these other things. And so if you look at any of the publications that come out of our group, they'll usually have the name Mick Mantle or Andy Seederman, and they develop many of the imaging techniques that we then use in the applications that I will talk about. So, what am I going to talk about this evening? I was well aware that not everyone in the audience, by a long chalk, was going to be a chemical engineer or even a chemist. And then I thought I would just explain what chemical engineering was and what we're trying to do in this field, and answer the question, why use magnetic resonance imaging and what is it? I mean, I'm sure everybody's come across MRI in the hospital environment. So we've got a fine picture of a magnetic resonance spectrometer there. When you come across them in the hospitals, they are always in a horizontal configuration, so you slide in and out of them. The systems that I will talk about have that magnet in a vertical direction. We do some of our rock core work in a horizontal flow system. So we'll have four or five of these beasts of various sizes and magnetic field strengths for the different applications we look at. So you can really have any orientation that you want. And really, it's just to say that when we're talking about chemical engineering systems, they're complex systems. And that's a photograph in the bottom right there of a gas-to-liquid plant that's going up in Qatar, has gone up in Qatar and is now operated by Shell. And that's very far from the chemistry or even the chemical engineering that goes on in most of our academic laboratories. And so how can we use an imaging technique which is sitting inside a laboratory to shed light on problems that are of interest to the real practitioners of chemical engineering? And that's why I was interested in taking magnetic resonance imaging into these areas. And I was going to illustrate what we're doing with by answering some specific questions here. What really happens inside a chemical process or a reactor? You often have competing theories developed by very eminent people in terms of what happens inside an optically opaque system. But until you have an imaging tool, you can't tell which theory is right. And hopefully I'll be able to illustrate, just with one example, at least how one can begin to shed light on which theory is right. And a lot of the work a chemical engineer does, and we were talking about this afternoon, is they have this problem of scale-up. You have the research going on at a bench level, or maybe at the level of size scale of this room, and then you want to go up to the full chemical plant, and that's a process that chemical engineers refer to as scale-up, and you'll see it in other branches of engineering as well. And numerical simulation is often the tool that you use to do that scale-up. And many of the things that we do now are actually imaging experiments, which are there to help develop and validate the flow simulation tools that will then be used at a much larger scale. So it's really a lot of thought has to go into how you perform experiments at a small scale so they can be relevant to the real chemical engineering problem. You also want to be able to study processes towards or at relevant process conditions. And I think we're getting to the stage now where with magnetic resonance imaging we can begin to do that. And I'll show you one example of an operating reactor inside one of these MRI systems. And it's also interesting to say, well, now I've got this tool, are there measurements that we can make with it which you can't make with any other technique? Okay, and you also want to be able to make these some of these measurements at low cost as well and move away from the large magnetic field technology which you come across in hospitals. And I'll touch on that on the very last slide. So the examples that I will take are around catalytic reactors and gas-liquid flows, and then I'll close out with a slide on future perspectives. So I thought I'd start off by saying, what is chemical engineering? I think I know what chemical engineering is, but I decided to consult the oracles. So I went to Google and I went to Wikipedia, and I much prefer Wikipedia, I'll tell you that. because Google reckoned it was the branch of engineering concerned with the design and operation of industrial chemical plants, and I think it's much more diverse than that, because you've got the whole of the food and the pharma industry in there as well. Whereas the Wikipedia definition is saying it's taking the physical sciences along with maths, economics and the life sciences and applying those to study processes that convert raw materials or chemicals into more useful or valuable forms. And I think that's a very good description of what a chemical engineer does. The areas that the process sectors or the technology sectors that we work with fall into chemical process technology, reaction engineering, the oil industry and the pharma sector. Okay, because what we do is we develop the tools which look at how chemical species move in and out of porous materials. So that's the same fundamental chemical engineering and physical chemistry that actually determines process performance in the chemical industry, in the oil industry, and in the pharma sector. In all of those problems, you're often dealing with multi-component and multi-phase systems that are almost always optically opaque, and hence the usefulness of magnetic resonance imaging, because it sees inside our bodies, which are multi-phase, multi-component, and optically opaque. And so that's the real huge advantage of being able to use the MRI technique in these applications. So how I got into this stuff was I'd come in from a physics background and then a chemistry background, came into the world of chemical engineering, and thought, these guys are building these most amazing models of things, but they don't actually know what goes on inside their process. So how do you begin to shed some light on that? And we're a long way off of solving all the problems, so I've got a lot more work to do, but this is a step towards looking at that in some cases. So I just thought I'd introduce, you know, why are we doing this work? What are the drivers for research in chemical engineering or reaction engineering? And I go back to what is now, I guess, an old document, but I've do a lot of work with Microsoft Research because they're interested in developing these new imaging technologies. And this was a book, a review they put out in 2006 called Towards 2020 Science, where they were talking about CO2 reduction, and we're all aware of the arguments about reducing the carbon footprint of chemical processes. But they were particularly arguing at this relatively early stage that in the chemical process sector, what we call demand reduction was important. It wasn't just about getting a catalyst, for example, that was more selective. It was about looking at the whole process and making sure that you reduce the carbon footprint of that process, and a big contribution towards doing that was actually, for example, you stop the over-design of a chemical process, design it more accurately, and, for example, as I'll give you on the next slide, stop the flow profile in pipes fouling up the system. So you then actually have to put more energy in it to get that process running. So here is that example. I'm certainly not going to go through this calculation, but it takes a simple example, again, just to bring home to you some of the things that a chemical engineer would worry about. Here we've got an oil pipeline, many pipes in a chemical reactor, and there's what a good example of a fouled pipe. So some process fluid has been going through that pipe. Deposit starts lining the pipe, and as a result of that, if that pipe was sitting in that environment, the heat would not transfer well from the process fluid into, say, a furnace that existed within that plant system. Okay, so then you would have to add additional heat into the system to get the furnace operating at the right temperature. That means you're using more fuel than you should do in an ideal system, in a clean system. So your carbon footprint of that process goes up. And in this example here, we were just considering a single plant producing 100,000 barrels of oil a day, and you would have a carbon footprint, an enhanced carbon footprint of that plant of 22,500 tons per annum. You actually produce 82 million barrels a day. And so just through clogging up pipes, because you don't understand the fluid mechanics properties within the pipes and can't clean them well enough, you're producing 18 million tons per annum of carbon. So, you know, it's very simple things like that. And that's just one aspect of a chemical plant. So the sorts of problems that one needs to understand in terms of understanding hydrodynamics through multi-phase flow-through pipe systems and chemical conversions actually are very relevant to a lot of the missions that are going on in the chemical industry today with respect to CO2 reduction. Just another example, I'll keep this picture of the chemical reactor here, is that a lot of that plant, and that not particularly that plant in case I deliberately haven't put the company that runs that plant up there, but any chemical plant, it has to be safe, it has to produce what the consumer wants, and so because you don't understand the detailed science of the way that plant operates, you over-design at each stage. So you make it bigger than it need be. It costs more than it need be, and it will need more fuel to operate it. Okay? And so we call that over-design, and we do that because we don't understand how the process really works. And that means nowadays, with this drive to reduce carbon footprint, there's a huge opportunity to develop and optimise chemical process technology. Gas-to-liquid conversion, which I've referred to earlier today, is one of those areas. We're used to the idea of taking crude oil and cracking it down to gasoline, octane, but now we want to look at gas-to-liquid technologies where we take a small molecule like methane and can we build that up to particularly the particular molecule that we want to generate. Okay, so we can produce cleaner fuels. That's another way of reducing our carbon footprint. And so where does MRI fit into that bigger picture? Well, here's some more pictures of the plants in Qatar. a lot of surface science and basic physical chemistry work going into understanding how catalysts operate inside reactors. Clearly, very small scale work, a lot of it going on under relatively low pressure conditions, ultra high vacuum in some cases still, although the community as a whole moves away from that. But still, this is very far distant from that. And so what we're trying to do with magnetic resonance imaging is begin to sit somewhere between these two. It's additive to what goes on in terms of the surface science and the physical chemistry of the system and the applications area, the large-scale work. So I've introduced MRI here. This is why we need it. And of course, much of the early work in NMR and MRI happened here in Aberdeen, and I'll refer to that later. The Nobel Prize for the particular application of MRI in physiology or medicine was in 2003 and went to Sir Peter Mansfield at the University of Nottingham and Paul Lauterbur in the States. And so the history of it here is in the 1930s, NMR was discovered. In the 1970s, many groups around the world were looking at MRI purely in terms of medical applications. By 2002, in that year, there were over 60 million MRI scans performed. And now I think every major hospital around the world will have one of these things. So in that previous slide, we know that MRI can produce pictures of what's going on inside you. But it's a highly flexible technique. And so another area that MRI is used in is what's called functional MRI, fMRI. And what that does, you can tune the signal intensity to see what's happening in different parts of the brain as certain functions are performed. So a standard one is, you know, tap your fingers, you see which part of your brain lights up. But obviously it's used to identify onset of disease and development of disease in individuals, as well as understanding the thought processes, how we think, what part of our brain is working to do that. And we can follow things that move. So this is a very early image taken in Cambridge, not by my group, and it's a cross-section through a rat's chest cavity. And so what you see there are the valves, heart valves, opening and shutting. So you have a very flexible, often complicated technique to use, which takes pictures, which allows you to track motion and also function. And so you can see that when you come in from a physical science background where you want to understand things more from first principles, and you come into the chemical engineering environment, there should be opportunities for this technique to translate it into the chemical engineering space. And this slide really summarizes that clearly I exaggerate, but at some level, a chemical plant is a black box. You know what goes in, you know what comes out the other end. To understand how this thing behaves, I need to know its internal structure, the chemical processes that happen, and the transport processes, the flow and diffusion processes that happen. And MRI, therefore, is a great tool because it has the capability, as yet then not developed for application into chemical engineering, but it should be able to do it. This is at the time I was leaving the chemistry department. They were just beginning to do some in situ catalysis work, magic angle spinning NMR. So really, how can we bring NMR spectroscopy along with spatial resolution to understand these sorts of chemical processes? So I've reproduced those pictures here to mention really what the research challenge is now. Because you could say, well, this doesn't sound very smart because it's all sitting there. So you just put the two bits together and off you go. But the problem is that a human subject, a biological system, is about, I don't know, 70%, 60, 70% water, if not a lot more. You're basically, we're all floppy and soft creatures. And that means, if you know anything about NMR, that when you excite, and I'll speak a little bit about this in a moment, when you actually put in the excitation pulse that causes a response in the system, which you then acquire to form the image, that the decay time is very long. It could be up to a second, which means that you've got a lot of time to acquire that data. When you come onto an engineering system where you might have ceramic, some metal, gas and liquid, it's a much harder challenge because that signal may decay in 5 milliseconds or 10 milliseconds. So your strategies for acquiring the data have to change. Also, if I was a chemist tracking a reaction with solid-state NMR, I would enrich in carbon-13, so I got a big carbon-13 signal in my NMR spectrum. If I'm going to run, albeit a small reactor inside an NMR machine, I can't afford litres of enriched carbon-13, so I have to find new strategies for signal enhancement. I'm also interested not just in bulk, sort of gross structure at the millimetre scale. I actually, if I want to start validating numerical codes, want to be able to get images down at, let's say, 50 to 500 microns. And minutes is no good for me. I want to start looking at transient processes. So I want to move away from 5-minute acquisitions and get it down to, let's say, 10 milliseconds. And of course, the medical community want to do this as well for very various reasons. Okay, so I just thought I'd give you a couple of slides on what the NMR technique is. It will only be two slides here, just to show you how one is acquiring the data. So let's imagine that we're going to map hydrogen in water, so it's the hydrogen nucleus. That's the most abundant nucleus to image, and that's what most people will image. It has two possible nuclear spin energy levels. They're at the same energy when they're inside a magnet, when they're not inside a magnetic field. When they are exposed to a magnetic field, there's an energy level separation. And so what you do then is you apply a radio frequency pulse of the appropriate energy to cause a resonant transition between those two energy levels. Okay? And so you excite the system by sending in a pulse of that energy and then record the decay of that system back to equilibrium. In NMR spectroscopy then, you Fourier transform that signal into a frequency response, a spectrum. Okay? If I was taking a spectrum of methanol, I would get two proton responses, one from the hydrogen in the OH group and another signal from the hydrogen in the CH3 group. I've got three more hydrogens, three times as many hydrogens in the CH3 group as the OH. They're separated in frequency space because they're different chemical environments, and it's a quantitative measure because the area under the curve tells me how many hydrogens I've got. So in all the imaging work that I do, I've got a technique that is chemically selective and also quantitative, as long as I apply it carefully. And when I want to image, all I do then is, if we just go back to this slide here, there's my magnetic field strength, B0. My resonant frequency is proportional to that field strength. Okay? If I want to get spatial resolution, let's have water in two test tubes, a lot of water in that one, a small amount of water in that one. What I do then is I put another magnetic field, which varies linearly in space, in the direction of the separation. And then I have an effective magnetic field. It's the original superconducting one, modified by this spatially varying one, which means that my resonant frequency now becomes a function of the absolute magnetic field strength at that particular position. Okay, which means then that instead of just a spectrum, I get a spatially resolved signal telling me how much water is in each of the two test tubes. If I want to measure in two dimensions, I put on magnetic field gradients in two dimensions. If I want a three-dimensional image, I put gradients on in three dimensions. Okay? So this is where the Aberdeen connection comes in particular, because the basic pulse sequence that is used to acquire these 2D images was certainly associated with the work of Edelstein, and there are many pulse sequences of this nature, but this is the one I reference a lot in my work, fortunately, as it turns out. And so I want to show this because this refers to how we speed up data collection later. If we want to take a 2D image, we essentially have to take a 2D raster of K-space, what we call K-space data points. And what Mansfield got the Nobel Prize for was working up, speeding up strategies for acquiring that 2D raster as fast as possible. So he developed a technique whereby you could acquire the data, all those green data points, off of one single excitation. And that took the imaging times down by probably an order of magnitude. So you acquire each of those data points in that 2D grid, and then you would do a 2D Fourier transform to give yourself the image. You can also encode anything you want into those image intensities. So you could have every pixel there is, let's say, water content. But you could also encode for chemical composition, for any velocity of moving fluid, or any diffusion coefficient of moving fluid at those points. So an extremely flexible tool. So I'll just give you some pictures to illustrate some of this. It's nice to see a movie every now and again. This is not an interesting chemical reaction. Well, it is interesting, but it's not a catalytic reaction. This is an oscillating chemical reaction, which if there are chemists in the audience, they, you know, you teach undergraduates to play around with oscillating chemical reactions, where you see the interconversion here of manganese 2+ and 3+ ions. And they have different relaxation time contrast effects on the water around them. And so you see this evolution of the chemical waves of the different manganese species here. I think there are some people lurking in the audience who work on oil recovery. And so another area where we're using the chemical selectivity here, so here are some typical rock cores. There they are. They go into the machine. We flooded one with hexadecane. So light colours are where you've got a lot of hexadecane. And then in that first frame, we have all hexadecane and no water. And then we're going to pump water through that system. So you will see the signal intensity build up from the water and be lost from the hexadecane. So you can image in real time the displacement processes that are occurring. I haven't synced those, so they're not going to work. There it goes. I'll start them off again together. But obviously you're using these, so you can actually see then the reciprocal nature and the displacement process. And then you can put a treatment fluid in there and see how the displacement process is modified. So I'm not going to go in through this slide at all. It's just to say that when we do image velocity fields, as I'm going to show you an example of it in a moment, you don't add a tracer into this. You do it simply with the pure fluid that's there. And what you're doing is you're able to monitor spatial position of species within the flow by putting in additional magnetic field gradient pulses. And I'm very happy to talk about that later, but the key point here is that you're not having to dope or distort the system in any way. It's a completely non-invasive measurement of the flow, and you can acquire flow data on flow rates from about 20 microns per second through to 5 to 10 meters per second, so a very flexible flow rate measurement. So there is a movie. It's a pipe, a cross-section through a pipe. Reynolds number, so it's a low flow rate of 1100 before you get unsteady state flow. And we've got the three vectors of the flow field there. So the colour scale is the flow velocity down the pipe. You've got fast flow in the centre, zero flow at the walls. And the little specks are the XY components of the flow vector in the transverse direction, the in-plane flow vector as you're looking at it there. As you go up in Reynolds number, up in flow rate, you know that flows become turbulent, they become unsteady, and you start to expect to see vortex structures forming in these flows. And again, one can show movies to one's heart's content, but you start seeing these structures within the flow. So if people work on fluid mechanics, you'll say, but I can do this with PIV. Yes, you would, and you would go off and use PIV on this problem. But as soon as you get an optically opaque flow, at that point, PIV is going to have a lot more problems. And it is useful then, having developed the MRI measurement, to study these flows. Right, so a quick dash through some work on reactors. So that's me with my hard hat on. I said Mick and Andy pop up throughout the work. So they look like my sort of henchmen, don't they? We're off on a BP plant going to look at a real trickle bed reactor in a petroleum refinery. That is the sort of reactor we're talking about here, where you have a catalyst sitting inside a cylindrical reactor. Sometimes you'll be operating these in what we call single phase flow, just pure gas or pure liquid going through them, and then chemically converting over this packing into product. Other times you'll be feeding in gas and liquid flows. And these are quite difficult systems to model and to understand. So these ideas of over-design will often come in terms of operating these types of reactor. So this answers my question, what really happens? So here is a cross-section through a model bed. We obviously work on real beds. But this is easier to see. So it's a packed bed of particles. We also use these as model systems for rock cores as well. And so where we've got a cross-section through the bed, through the particle, you get no signal. So those are the black elements there. Everywhere you see colour, that is actually where liquid is and the velocity with which it's moving down through that column. So where you've got fast flow, that's the yellow pixels. Where you've got slow flow or almost stagnant flow, zero flow, are the blue regions. So what this tells you is that from an operating point of view, much of your bed isn't being used because the conversion happens where the pellets are, where the catalyst pellets are. And if they're in an almost stagnant environment, then that's not good. Okay? The folklore was also that you would get these high velocities around the edge, and you do. But you also get some of them internally within the bed. And so that immediately tells guys who, and I use guys to refer to men and women in case I get accused of being sexist there, how they should design the form of these catalyst pellets to promote certain flow regimes within those reactors. Of course, all that stuff we can never publish. But that's how this stuff is actually used in practice. We can do it in 3D, develop the tools to do this in 3D. So there's a section through a full 3D volume where the dark grey is where the particles are, the light grey is where gas is, and now we're tracking where the liquid streams fall through that bed in 3D and the velocity at which they're moving at. But that's not enough if you actually want to develop new simulation codes of multi-phase flows in these systems. And this is something we've done here, where you see green and blue colours, that's where liquid is. Where you see red and yellow, that's where gas is. And both are encoded for velocity. So they're the velocity maps of both the gas flow and the liquid flow. Now you might say, so what? That's a real measurement challenge because the gas density, you're getting signals back from the nuclei in the molecules. Okay, and the gas density, as you know, is three orders of magnitude less than the liquid density. So you're three orders of magnitude down in sensitivity. Now, what we want to do is actually explore what the gas and liquid velocities are at a gas-liquid interface. Because when you go off to whatever numerical flow simulator you use to, say, predict my two-phase flow in this system, what it will do behind the scenes is it will make certain assumptions about the relationship of the gas and liquid flow at the interface. Because no one's actually been able to demonstrate what it is precisely in these types of tortuous geometries. Okay? And these relationships are called closure relationships mathematically. And so what you can do now, first measurements of actually being able to explore what that relationship is across the gas-liquid boundary. Now to do this, we've actually had to use some of the modern signal processing techniques, compressed sensing, and new sampling strategies to be able to get the appropriate sensitivity level to be able to record these data. Because you'll note, if you can see that from where you are, that both the gas map and the liquid map are recorded at the same spatial resolution. Because if you went and recorded the gas map at a coarser resolution, then you'll have such bad registration across the interface that you will not really be looking at what the real gas and liquid velocity are across that interface. So this is very much a case saying, how do we use small-scale experiments to help the people who generate the numerical simulation codes to produce much more effective codes in terms of prediction of two-phase flows in complex geometries? Right, a quick one here, just to show you some movies here. Looking at transitions in trickle beds, often they're used in what's called trickle flow, where you've got a stable gas-liquid distribution as the gas and liquid flow through the bed. If you increase the gas and liquid velocity, you can go into what's called the pulse flow regime, which is not well understood, but you get much more dynamic gas-liquid contacting. So there is much to understand in terms of the theories for this hydrodynamic transition. Some people would say you actually want to work at the transition, because there's a playoff between the amount of energy you're putting in the system to increase the flow rates by going up into the fully pulsing transition. So these are cross sections through a reactor, okay, and where you see the signal intensity, that's coming from the liquid. So that's trickle flow, and what you should see there is that the signal intensity is staying spatially constant, because the liquid distribution is constant. If you come up to pulsing flow, you've got a lot more liquid there, you've upped the liquid flow rate, and you can see the liquid flow is chaotic. But the controversy was, what's the right theory to explain this transition? Okay, does it go chaotically from that state across to that state? Or do you move through a process of local pulses which then interconnect, like a percolation theory problem? Okay. So if we just play this movie, you immediately see in this system what the right theory was. Because most of that liquid distribution is staying constant, that you'll see something flick on and off there, and there's one that does it over here, that one. I'll go again in a minute. Okay, so you can actually see then an image when you're sitting in this transition, the evolution of these local pulsing events, which then join up. And here we do it in 3D. So what we've done here is just looked at the standard deviation in the signal intensity over a time course of images. So where you have a high standard deviation, as in red, that's where you've got pulses forming. So there's low flow rate, everything's stable. Two pulses there. The number of pulses grow and interconnect until at high velocity, the whole bed becomes unstable. And this was really just to say that's not the end of the story, because we want to be useful and you can't put real chemical plant inside NMR systems. So what we did then was we said, well, reaction engineers use pressure drop measurements and conductance measurements on plant. So how can we track this transition using those established techniques? So what I plotted here is the evolution of the number of pulses as a function of liquid velocity as you go through the transition. And you see that the conductance measurements are sensitive to the fully pulsing system. And pressure drop measurements can tell you at the onset of the transition and the liquid velocity at which you've got the maximum number of pulses there. So you're actually able to shed light on what's the right theory for describing this process, and then go back to the engineers and say, now you can track it on your real system. And then this is just a nice movie. There's a lot of interest in trying to operate beds at non-steady state. And this map here, liquid is yellow, gas is blue. And so you see we're going through constant gas velocity, and we're low liquid velocity, high liquid velocity, low liquid velocity, high liquid velocity. And you can see how the bed fills and empties with liquid. So traditionally, you would then monitor the liquid hold up, as it's called, within the bed, and put that in your simulation just by putting conductance rings around the reactor and say this is how much liquid is there. If you then put that into the simulation, you don't predict the conversion in that bed. Why don't you? Well, it's because you can clearly see that each of those catalyst pellets has a very different contacting environment around it. Okay? So if you've got the image there, you can then, so that's a cartoon of the image, you can look at the local elements of void space between the particles and look at the local contacting profiles. And then when you do that and feed that into the simulation, you're able to predict the conversion much more effectively. Okay. So I now want to move away from the hydrodynamics and then say, but we can also do some chemical mapping here. Okay. This is an example of carbon-13 mapping of an octene hydrogenation reaction on a palladium alumina catalyst. This is just the introduction to it. This is the carbon-13 spectrum of octene. It's got a widely separated, what we call a doublet in spectroscopy. When we convert through to the alkane, there's no double bond anymore, so nothing in the signal. And if we produce isomers of octene, you get a narrow doublet. Okay? And so we can start tracking our reaction here. So there's our bed, there's our catalyst, the black material in the middle there. There's the boundaries of the bed tracked along here. And what we can do is we can spatially resolve the spectroscopy down the bed and hence track the chemistry that's occurring through that bed. So you can see that before the octene hits the catalyst, you've just got the widely separated doublet of the octene. This is operating under low flow rate conditions, so you get a lot of isomerization. As soon as it hits the catalyst, you start forming the two octenes. And you can track the reaction down the bed on the time scale of a few minutes. So here we see the loss of one octene and the formation of the two octenes and the octanes. So you can look at the hydrodynamics in the system and you can look at the chemistry in the system. So what we're really into now, so this becomes the fun bit. So we've developed the tools. It's taken us a long time to develop the tools. Now we want to develop the hardware. That means we can put things that look like real reactors inside this system. So here is our reactor now, our fixed bed, that can go up to 350 degrees C and 30 bar. So for the catalyst people, that's getting into the low temperature Fischer-Tropsch area. And so now we can actually look at the catalyst working under real process conditions, or something approximating much more the process conditions that we might see in that Shell plant in Qatar. Okay, so just to orient you, that's the reactor that you've just seen here, and it sits inside the big vertical NMR system. So that's the geometry of it. Here's a cartoon of it. We're going to look at this thing called the ethene oligomerization reaction, which just means you keep adding ethene molecules onto one another, and you retain one carbon-carbon double bond, and then what's called the aliphatic chain, the chain that doesn't contain double bonds, grows. Okay, so it's a polymerization process, essentially. Okay, and we're going to look at this reactor operating at 110 and just over 200 degrees and at a pressure of 29 atmospheres. So we're going to get signal back from the liquid products, and that's interesting here at 110 degrees. Obviously, ethene's coming in as a vapor. The liquid products, anything that's produced from this conversion, comes through as a liquid at 110 degrees. Okay? So all the signal intensity you see there of any note is coming from the products, which is four chain carbons and greater. If you go up to 200 degrees, then the C4 products are actually in the vapor as well. And the signal intensity, again associated predominantly with the liquid species, is the C6s and beyond. So you see far less signal intensity when you're operating at higher temperature because your gas phase C4 products are going to be far less visible. So you start seeing clearly the liquid distribution within your reactor, which in itself can actually be illuminating to people. But of course, you can be doing spectroscopy at the same time as mapping the liquid distribution. So here we haven't spatially resolved the chemistry that goes on. The spectra are being taken from the whole bed, but they're being taken as a function of time. And so then we get two peaks, the olefinic peak from the double bond region and this blue aliphatic peak from the blue long chain. And then we're just plotting the peak intensities here as a function of time on stream, and you'll see the aliphatic peak chain peak growing as a function of time on stream. What you can also do is measure the diffusion coefficient of the molecules that are existing within the bed at different spatial positions. And so we can see the diffusion coefficient of the ethene species at the top of the bed. By the time we get to the bottom of the bed, we see no evidence of ethene anymore. We see a range of much slower diffusion coefficients, and they are defining the limits of the products, the range of products that we're producing within that conversion. But of course, if we have the spectra, even without the diffusion coefficients, we can actually then start fitting these data to kinetic models. And the kinetic model in this example that one takes is something called the Schultz-Flory model. And again, I'll not go into the detail here, but once you have that model, you can then actually, as a function of time on stream, work out from those data the product distribution as a function of time, straight from those reactor data. So in this example here, you see that in the early stages of the reaction, the black line, T equals 10 minutes, you produce long chain hydrocarbons, and then once the system settles down, you actually reach steady state producing much smaller chain hydrocarbons. You can also start monitoring the carbon laydown during this process as well. So a huge number of things that you can begin to measure. And this is just an example that my student just gave me the last week, where he's now actually tracking the conversion and doing that experiment you saw for the whole bed as a function of time, but now getting the spectra at 94 positions, I think he took, along the length of the reactor. So you get the spatial resolution on the conversion as well. So what I want to finish off with is just a few quick examples of some of the new areas that we're looking at. We actually have used some of those techniques in the data that I've shown you, but I decided to separate this off as a different section and give a little talk around gas-liquid flows. So this is what I call conventional imaging. So this is essentially what Edelstein and Mansfield Lauterbur were working on, okay, where you sample the whole of the 2D grid that I mentioned earlier, then do the 2D Fourier transform and get an image. So I've taken an image which we're now bored of by now because it's a cross-section through a fixed bed of spheres. Okay. Clearly, if you want to go faster than Mansfield's pulse sequence, where you do one excitation and sample that whole grid, you have to find a way of what we call undersampling. So you sample fewer points and then reconstruct the image from that. There are many techniques that will do this. The approach we're using is compressed sensing or compressive sensing. So obviously there is an optimization process in doing this in this compressed sensing reconstruction, but that's the first step in terms of things that we want to be able to do. But if we want to go even faster, I'll give you an example of having done something with that in a moment, you could say, actually, I don't want to reconstruct an image. All I want to know is the size of the particles, right? I don't care where they are. It doesn't bother me at all. I just want to know the dimension, in which case I don't need to acquire so many points because I don't need the picture. And at that point, you can move across to sampling far fewer data points and using Bayesian strategies, which, of course, have been around in physics and engineering and beyond for many, many, many years, and mathematics, of course. Okay, so I want to just give you a few quick examples here, and I'm going to take bubbles so we have a break from fixed beds. So, bubbly systems, gas-liquid bubbly flows, they look simple. They are actually a kind of chemical engineering nightmare, really, because it's very difficult to measure these systems. All the optical techniques have problems. As soon as you get a lot of gas bubbles flowing through, you get scattering off of all the gas-liquid interfaces, and the tools don't work. So you can use techniques which tell you how much gas is there, but not what the bubble size distribution is. But knowing this is a really important part of many chemical engineering processes, and I've listed off a few there. Oil transportation, nuclear cooling systems, and obviously gas-liquid reactors. Okay, so if one can crack this, that is actually a very useful measurement tool. And so, well, can MRI do it? I'm obviously going to be able to tell you that it can do, but not using the conventional fastest possible technique of Mansfield. Because actually where you've got gas and liquid moving together, you have a lot of shear at that interface, and that causes the EPI technique, the echoplanar imaging technique of Mansfield's, to fail. It produces artifacts. So at 5 volume percent gas, the gas bubbles, the little black regions, you kind of get an image back, it's okay, it has some artifacts. 10 volume percent, it's hopeless. There's no way you can get a bubble size distribution off of that. Okay, but clearly we want to be able to look at 10 volume percent, 40 volume percent gas. So how do we go around doing that? So this is where we start using compressed sensing. So if people haven't come across it before, it's really, I think of JPEG compression, which many of you do know something about. There's a picture of the team that were working on this. Okay, a full image, 769 kilobytes. Let's put ourselves through a wavelet transform. Okay. There we are. But now let's say I'm only going to keep one in every 25 data points, the most intense data points. And then I'll put myself back to an inverse wavelet transform. It doesn't have to be a wavelet transform. And I've reconstructed the picture of the group, but it's a lot smaller. The picture's been compressed. Okay? What compressed sensing does, and this is what we've been doing with, we certainly did not invent this, so please don't go away thinking that I'm claiming that. But it's burst back onto the scene again in the past years, and we've been working with Microsoft Research doing this. What it says is, well, if I didn't need all those data points in the first instance to reconstruct the image, why did I ever acquire them? Okay? So the skill then is to identify what the sampling schemes are in K-space, so you acquire the smallest possible number to reconstruct a good image. Okay, so that's the name of the game. So that was where we started off at the beginning of this lecture with the rectilinear grid, and I said you sampled every point. Now we start using fancy schemes such as what's called spiral sampling and even more exotic sampling schemes combined with the compressed sensing reconstruction to really take MRI into new avenues of application. So here we go, up to 40 volume percent gas now. We can image the system perfectly well, no blurring of the image. I've sort of blotted, these are actually velocity fields as well of the liquid phase around the bubbles. Okay, so we're able to get velocity information back and a quantitative velocity information as well as defining where the bubbles are clearly. Obviously, we can just take some images without the velocity information, where the bubbles are much clearer. I've just blanked them out here so you can see what's happening, and just movies of a bubble swarm going through. And using conventional MRI, you couldn't begin to take those measurements. And this one is a single bubble, but it's a fun system. And my student, Alex Taylor, who started work for Schlumberger yesterday. I'm not too pleased with Schlumberger at the moment. Right, where are we? Yeah, there it goes. So a single bubble. But what you're acquiring now is the X, Y, and Z flow vector around that rising bubble. Okay? So 63 frames per second for that three-vector flow field. And what you can see as the bubble rises, you can see the turbulent wake behind it. So where we want to go with this now, obviously single bubbles are pretty, but we actually want to actually understand how bubbles coalesce and break up. What's happening during that process? Because again, from a fluid mechanics point of view, they are very interesting problems. And I just take individual frames out here where you see the vortex shedding behind the bubble as it rises up through that column. And then absolutely finally, the last application is a Bayesian example, and I'll keep the theme of bubbles here. And these are my colleagues, Andrew Blake, who now heads Cambridge Microsoft in the UK, and Dan Holland, who did this work as part of his postdoc and now has a faculty position, where we're saying here, we're going to use the Bayesian technique. We don't want an image. We just want the information back. So there's Bayes' theorem, and I'm sure there are people in the audience who are far more expert than I am on Bayes' theorem. That's the translation of it when it comes to a bubble size experiment. But essentially what we're doing is we're saying, if my bubbles are of size X, what should be the K-space or time domain response of the signal for bubbles of size X? And calculate it. Okay? You can do that then for bubbles of any size, do that calculation. You then acquire the experimental data and say, which of the simulated data sets does my data statistically agree with best? Okay, so that's essentially what the Bayesian approach is doing here. And I'll just show you the example of that here. So here are two bubbly flows. These two, obviously, we can analyze optically. And I've shown that by the solid lines in each plot. And then the Bayesian analysis gives us the dashed line. So you can see that where we can validate with optical measurements, we get extremely good agreement. Now, the difference here is to take an image where you could actually resolve all those bubbles, it would typically be a 256 by 256 array, so that's 40,000 data points, and every data point you acquire takes a finite amount of time to acquire it. Okay? We can take these measurements with 40 data points. So that is 10 to the 3 speed up in the measurement. And because in many cases we're looking at rapidly moving systems, we couldn't actually acquire the 40,000 data points because the system would have moved through our field of view and we'd have just got blurring. So we're actually, through this technique, again, being able to make measurements which conventional MRI wouldn't be able to address in any way. So let's go up to a high voidage system, a gas system. So clearly, you're not going to do any optical analysis of that, but the MR data doesn't seem to bother the Bayesian MR system analysis at all. And you know, you can then do cross-checks like, well, you can measure how much liquid there is in that system using MR and check that that agrees with the gas-liquid ratios you are passing through the pipe. So you can do that sort of standard benchmarking to check that this can't be a crazy measurement. But it is beginning to open up measurements that we couldn't make using different techniques. And just to close now, how are we using this in other fields? And it kind of takes us back to the medical area again. But I slid in an oil recovery one too. So essentially what we were doing with the Bayesian experiment there was we were just saying, it doesn't really matter that it's a bubble that we were looking at. We were looking at vaguely spherical objects and sizing them. That's what we were doing. And if you think about trying to measure the pore size in rocks or the grain size in rocks, that's really what you're trying to do then. So that's exactly what we did do. We took that technique. So normally what you would do is you would be putting those rock cores into an X-ray microtomography system to look at the microstructure. But now you can actually do the grain sizing using this Bayesian NMR approach. And that's some work that we've been doing with Schlumberger, and obviously they will then, I'm sure, well, I know, be putting that technique onto their logging tools, or seek to put it onto their logging tools. Okay? But another completely different example, osteoporosis, the degradation of the cellular structure within bone. Why can't you start looking at the evolution of that materials problem? Because as the microstructure changes, so the NMR experiment should be able to look at the change in cell size inside the bone. By cell size, I mean void space size. And of course, if you could actually get that working in a medical environment where you could do that experiment while someone is lying in the magnet, that's a very useful capability to put back into MRI. So although our interests are very much grounded in engineering and will remain so, we have now got two areas in the functional MRI sector and in the osteoporosis area where we think that some of the new tools that we're developing and the work being generated by our mission to solve chemical engineering problems does actually feed back into the medical space. So in the functional MRI area, what engineers, I said, engineering systems, you look at lots of different components, ceramic, gas, liquid, sometimes metal being present. So materials with very different RF susceptibility problems. And where some of the MRI measurements in the medical field are challenged is where, for example, you're looking at a joint where you have what we call multiple T2 problems in that system. And so the techniques that we've used to look at engineering systems actually might be able to help or add a little something back into the medical MRI space, where they're looking at particularly difficult parts of the body. So in the functional MRI work we were doing, you could see that the techniques we had gave fewer artifacts, for example, in a head section where you were going through the eye socket. So it's exciting times for us, lots of engineering stuff to do, but also seeing some of the spin-off back into the medical space. And so just to close, I've been talking about these beasts, the big superconducting magnets. They're big, they're expensive, but they have high signal-to-noise associated with them, and if I'm trying to understand chemical engineering systems, I'm going to work mostly there. But, of course, these things are benchtop systems, so this Earth's so-called Earth's field magnet, very low magnet systems, not superconducting magnets, they don't need cryogens, they would fit on here. Can I start making these machines actually take useful data from a process context? There are some low-field systems already in place in the food industry. And, of course, the NMR logging tool is another example of a very low-field system. And so a large amount of our work now is in using the compressed sensing and the Bayesian methods to overcome some of the signal-to-noise problems of working at low-field by translating these techniques across into this low-field capability. So plenty of things to keep myself and my group going. I'd like to thank them once again and our major sponsors who have stuck with us through thick and thin. So Johnson Matthey, Microsoft Research, Schlumberger, ExxonMobil, and of course, the Engineering and Physical Sciences Research Council. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Lynn. We weren't happy that you pinched our Professor of Radiology into Cambridge, so...
I have met her, yeah.
We've got some time for questions. I would suppose probably about 5-10 minutes, but questions... Could I start the ball rolling? And this might sound a really stupid question, but I'm used to asking stupid questions. You said that... In medicine, usually the magnets are horizontal, and you're using them vertical. Does that affect the physics of the
no.
measurements or anything? It's just
no, everything is it remains the same.
Yeah. Okay. Mm. And then the other question I was going to ask was, you were saying you were going to do a test. You're using it to do a test bed, and you had your machine where you can go up to different pressures and temperatures. But in Qatar, there's the external environment of heat and particularly heat, I would say. Does that affect your measurements? And how do you allow for that when you...
No, I mean, well, inside the magnet, so the magnet has a bore, so you can see there somebody sticking a probe up the inside of that magnet. So that will be temperature controlled.
Right.
And the whole experiment is done in a temperature controlled environment. And then when you go back to the reactor that is inserted into it, again, if I flip back through some of these. Nearly there. Okay, so the actual reactor part there is just that vertical part, which looks sort of cream there.
Yeah.
It's that arm that then gets put down inside the magnet. And all that is temperature controlled via electronics. This is a flow rig, but it then goes off through to an electronic system. So everything there is temperature controlled and monitored. So there's a proper engineering process control system around that.
So it really does replicate the environment in Qatar. Mm-hmm. Jim?
Lynn, all of the examples you gave, you had a static solid system, but mobile fluids. Mm-hmm. So what about if the solid is also mobile? So I'm thinking about, you talked about Fischer-Tropsch, which of course is mainly slurry bed. What about fluidized beds? So how far away, what are the additional complications?
Yeah, no, so fluidized beds, we've done a lot of work on fluidized beds, but I think you have to be really quite careful about what you're doing in fluidized beds. So to get image back from image intensity back from the solid, you have to cheat in some way. There will be some solids you can just about get a signal off of. And this is all to do with the intrinsic relaxation time that they have. If you just want to start understanding the flow fields of solids, a trick that chemical engineers use often to study granular systems is to use mustard or poppy seeds, food seeds. And they use those even before we started using them for MRI. You use them for MRI because then the natural oils within the seed give you an NMR signal. So therefore you can map the flow velocity of the solids, the spatial distribution of the solids, and you can get movies of those back just as we did with the gas liquid systems. The other way of dealing with it is to liquid impregnate the solids. So you're forcing some liquid into them and you're recording the liquid from those. I mean, that is a bit of a cheat because you're also then changing the fluidization properties of the solid, so I don't like that one too much. But now, of course, we can begin to look at the gas phase directly, which a few years ago we wouldn't have been able to. So you could start looking, not worrying about trying to use a model solid that you can get an NMR signal from, but actually getting the image, the information on the gas distribution and the gas velocity. But it's obviously a very similar problem to the gas liquid flows. So you have to be really careful designing what the question is you're trying to answer, because as you know, apart from an FCC cracker, we could just about look at that at the right pipe diameter. But anything that's operated on a bigger size scale in the real sort of fluidization processes outside of FCC, then you've obviously got a lot of convective flow fields as well in those systems. So it's not just a matter, you know, it's to what extent are you the edge effects, the boundary effects of your column in a small system wrecking and interfering too much with the physics that would be happening on the big scale. And so that's why, you know, I showed you the single bubble problem or video. And that's why we'd say that's a useful one to look at, because actually understanding and getting the maths and physics right of bubble coalescence and breakup, that is useful understanding that can go into the numerical simulation codes and be used in the scale-up and be used in, population balance models, CFD population balance models.
Could you just introduce yourself? I should have said.
Sure. Hi, Lynn. It's Neil Renton here.
Hi there.
Hi, how are you? Could you just you mentioned scale-up at the end there. Could you say a little about something about the success or lack of success there's been in trying to scale up to full-size processes, from some of the measurements?
Yeah.
And particularly on the chemical, I can see the hydrodynamic, the fluid mechanics mm-hmm. problems, but how about the chemical reaction results?
With the chemical reaction results, I mean, the chemical reaction results are obviously the high temperature, high pressure stuff we've only done in the last 3 or 4 months. Mm. With one of the industrial partners we've worked with there, and clearly, a lot of it we don't publish. The sorts of information, it's more like insight into, I shall not use bad language in a forum such as this, but I can remember a colleague from industry saying they understood everything about the process. And then he looked at one of these and went, oh. It was things like, without giving the game away, once you think that you've purged a system or regenerated it in some way, actually what was left behind within that catalyst. So being able to optimize or gain some insight into why, let's say, a regeneration protocol isn't working as you'd have expected it to. That's the sort of area where we can see that the initial results that we're getting are having some, they're getting a positive response, put it that way.
Any more?
My name's Richard Johnson. I'm a retired microscopist. I was wondering about the limits to resolution. You've been showing tubes with, say, 10 catalytic particles or whatever across, and you're getting useful flow information. How small a tube of that sort of configuration can you get useful flow information from, and what are the limits to
that? So the limits are all signal to noise. And remember, I mean, I didn't say this, so you can't remember it, but the NMR is a relatively insensitive technique. The best resolution that we have had on a system like that is 7 microns. And we have looked at what we would call microcapillary flows, but that's why they're more microchannel flows. So channels of, let's say, a square cross section, 100 or 200 micron. And we were imaging flow fields and chemical mapping there. I think the paper we wrote was 15 micron resolution. So in that problem, we were looking at, you know, mixing in different junction configurations and the flow field and the chemistry that occurred thereafter. So really, I mean, if you think about it, what you're doing is, if you've got the time to acquire the data, the maximum resolution in terms of data array that you would acquire on would be, let's say, 256 by 256. And the smallest imaging coil, which is your image, your field of view, normally that we would take, would be a 5 millimeter cross section. But again, then you're only going to get those what I would call high resolutions, which clearly wouldn't be high resolutions by your standards, when you've got a system which isn't changing much with time and you can afford to take, you know, signal average many times. And that again is where these speed-up techniques that I'm talking about, I didn't mention this at all, but it's another reason for exploring these, because then if you can signal average much, much faster, the possibility for getting higher spatial resolution also becomes a greater possibility.
Hi, Alex Murdoch. My question is regarding the experiment where you're tracking the products in the FT reactor. Would the technique be sensitive enough to also track intermediates on the surface of the catalyst?
Yes. Now, we haven't shown it in that reactor, but we have shown that in some other systems that we've looked at. When you go up in temperature, I did put one equation up which I didn't discuss, but I think you'll all be happy with the idea that the signal to noise in the system doesn't work in your favor as you increase temperature because you get more noise there. Okay? So things will get harder when we're working at elevated temperature, but certainly if you're looking at a gas phase system, at higher pressure, you'll get more nuclear spin density, so that does work in your favor, so it kind of balances itself out. And we have been tracking some conversions where we see intermediates there. So the answer is yes, but there's an awful lot more work to do on that. There's another whole set of work which I didn't talk about because it wasn't associated with imaging, but is actually, of course, we don't ignore straight spectroscopy. And also some things called relaxation time measurements, which, you know, not nearly as groovy as showing an image, but actually tell you a huge amount about what's going on the surface. So what will happen then is, let's say you've got quite a complicated multi-component chemical system present within the catalyst. You can actually monitor, each of them will have a different relaxation time. So the time they take to return, their signal takes to return to equilibrium after you've excited them, okay? Now, this turned out to be a nuisance when we first started this work, because if different molecular species have different relaxation times, if you just take a spectrum or a spatially resolved spectrum, you can no longer trust your signal intensities. So this is an absolute curse for this to happen. And then we thought, well, actually, if we accept that it's happening, it's really useful to us. And so what happens is, the stronger a molecule is interacting with the surface, the more significantly its relaxation time is reduced from its bulk properties. So what you can start to track then is not just the chemical species that are sitting there over a time average period, but also their relative strength of interaction with the surface, so that you can start beginning to understand how different selectivity pathways are followed in a kinetic scheme. And that's something we're doing. We've got quite a few people working on now trying to understand that. Because I think, you know, being able to understand, or my interest now is, you know, if you speak to a catalysis person, they'll come up with grand kinetic schemes for the way a reaction's working. But what are the key steps in that process? I mean, essentially, I'm talking about doing a microkinetic analysis, as Dumezic and Bell would be doing, and many other people do. But we can, I think this is another tool that goes in with those microkinetic tools there, which can give you some insight on the intermediates, and the important intermediates, and can also start telling you why certain paths are important in that reaction scheme and which ones can be ignored.
Okay, we've got time for last question for refreshment, please.
Jiabao He from Aberdeen Biomedical Imaging Centre. You showed very beautiful images at high resolution in turbulent systems. I just wonder, how do you address the field inhomogeneity issues? Apparently, you're imaging at very fast pace, and you must have some clever ways to deal with it.
Yeah, I mean, that was going back a long time, a fairly long time for those pipe flow experiments. I mean, what we did do is we spent quite a lot of time optimizing the pulses that we were using, putting in composite pulses, and pulses that were robust to magnetic field susceptibility variations. We would now, particularly if we were going to look at a multi-phase system in pipe flow, we couldn't do that with EPI, because the inhomogeneity would be too much. And so we would be using spiral sampling then. But for the single phase flow, we did not have, apart from optimizing the pulses and tweaking those, we didn't have problems in actually acquiring those data.
Okay, fascinating. So I started off with mega engineering, but in fact it was all about micro engineering. But it was very, very interesting. And it's, I think what you're also demonstrating, something which we're trying to do here at Aberdeen, is get this cross-disciplinary work in. So, you know, from medicine to chemical engineering and back again. And I think that's an illustration of some of the things we're doing here as well, which is great. So with that, can I thank everyone for coming tonight. Thank you very much for a really interesting talk. And please do stay for some refreshments afterwards. And thank you very much.
Thank you.